It's personal between me and I'm going to do you some serious harm, you big stiff idiot.
The Untouchable True School Sports Empire proudly presents Something the Boxing Game's Missing. Hey, what's going on? It's your boy BT, and I came here to talk some boxing with the thousands of True School Sports subscribers. All right, so in this particular video, I'm going to talk about a couple things. So make sure you guys pay attention to the timestamps down below because it's very important if you want to hear a certain part of the video. But starting off, man, listen, if you're somebody that's like really hell-bent on wanting to see Canelo versus Diaz Benavidez, I have some bad news for you guys, real bad news, because, you know, shout out to the man, Constantino Garcia, Little Giant Boxing. He was doing an interview recently with Eddie Reynoso, who many of us know is Canelo's trainer, but many people don't realize that Eddie Reynoso was also Canelo's manager simultaneously, so he's the responsible for picking these fights. But Eddie Reynoso was speaking to Little Giant Boxing, and he pretty much stated that, listen, like, he wants to make the Jermall Charlo fight. Yes, Jermall Charlo, you heard me correctly, because Charlo did an interview recently, and he stated that he would be willing to do the same thing for Canelo that John Ryder is doing right now, which is to fight Canelo in Mexico. Now, here's what Reynoso said about that. I'll quote him, and then we will dissect from there. He stated the following, and I quote, "Well, hopefully, Charlo will love to come to Mexico. It's a fight that is important and a fight we want to make," end quote. So there you have it. So the Canelo camp is expressing interest in making that fight. Should Canelo, you know, be victorious against John Ryder, you know, and maybe if he foregoes a Bivol fight, this is another potential option for him, because now Charlo has opened that door to where he's willing to go to Mexico to fight Canelo. Now, much like many fights in boxing that are big matchups, this fight doesn't mean what it meant 3 years ago. It's not what it would have been 2 or 3 years ago, because for one, Charlo has been active for about two years, and he's just trying to find himself outside of boxing, let alone in boxing. So he needs to get active again, and I don't think it would look good if Canelo picked him right now, considering the fact that David Benavidez is getting a lot of momentum. He just had a really great performance against Caleb Plant on pay-per-view, and that's a fight that genuinely I think would be exciting and would do good business. It makes a lot of business sense, so why not make the fight? Charlo, as far as the landscape of 160 and 68, he's been irrelevant for the better part of over a year. So he needs to get active. So this should be all the ammunition Diaz Benavidez fans need to say that Canelo is ducking, or he's going to duck Diaz Benavidez, you know? And truth be told, listen, it's not really a fight like I need to see. I mean, if it happens, cool. But like, if he ever fights Jermall Charlo anytime soon and doesn't fight Diaz Benavidez, I will call it a duck, because it is. Like, how on God's green earth you're gonna forego a Benavidez fight? Like, if you fight Bivol, cool. I can understand that. If he goes, you know, I can understand all that. But if you're gonna forego Benavidez, then the only reason it should be is for Bivol, because that's the guy that beats you. He's a great fighter. He's undefeated. He's made like 8 or 9 title defenses. He's arguably the best pound-for-pound fighter in the sport. He's got a claim to that, I think. So it makes a lot of sense to fight him. But to fight Jermall Charlo would be just an ultimate cherry pick. So fingers crossed that doesn't happen, and Canelo Alvarez doesn't get me back into the mode I used to be in, where, you know, I said he was exposed and I used to kind of like not like the guy. Kind of hated the guy, to be honest. So, you know, let's not go down that route, because I don't want to go down that route. But it is what it is there. Now, switching gears, John Fury, you know, the father of Tyson Fury, he was speaking to the media recently about Tyson Fury and his career plans. And as you guys know, next April 15th, Joe Joyce is fighting Zhang Zhilei, and what's going to be a great fight. So naturally, John Fury is being asked a lot of questions about his son, Tyson, fighting Joe Joyce. And the answers he's giving aren't necessarily the most encouraging, because it's further making Tyson Fury and his camp and everyone around him look like, you know, people that don't want to fight top competition. So here's what he said about a Joe Joyce fight. Stated the following, and I quote, how do you get yourself up for that? Joe Joyce doesn't have any belts. Of course Joyce deserves his shot at the title, but when you are gearing up for a fight with undisputed and you go back to the drawing board and start again, it is the question of getting up for it. And that's what it is. He said no one is, and he basically said that no one is interested in Joe Joyce. which he's not wrong. Like, John Fury's right. Nobody's interested in seeing Joe Joyce versus Fury because the fight we want is the Usyk undisputed fight. But unfortunately, we can't have that because Tyson Fury, every time Usyk concedes and makes a concession, Tyson Fury moves the goalpost more. It's very reminiscent, honestly. It's very reminiscent of like Amir Khan versus Kell Brook. You know, every time Amir Khan stated a stipulation, Kell Brook would do it or meet it, and Amir Khan moved the goalpost because at the end of the day, Amir Khan didn't want to fight Kell Brook, and we saw why when they fought in 2022. We saw why that happened. So I genuinely feel like Tyson Fury is holding up the division. It's really annoying to me because I hate it in any weight class when the guys at the top can't make decisions, can't make big fights happen, and they hold the division up because then it has a trickle-down effect to the contenders, to the fringe contenders, and the prospects, and then the whole, and then it's just like this never-ending effect that never ends. So Fury versus Joyce, I think, to me, if Joyce beats Zhang, right, and mind you, that's not going to be easy because we saw Zhang arguably beat Filip Hrkovic, and he's one of the hardest punching fighters in the division, so that's not an easy fight. So if he gets past Zhang, you're talking about Joe Joyce beating Zhang, Joseph Parker, Daniel Dubois, Brian Jennings, Nathan Gorman when he was undefeated. You know, he had that's a pretty damn good resume. I would definitely say probably one of the best resumes in the heavyweight division, champion or contender. So he would definitely, you know, have done his fair share to warrant a Tyson Fury fight. And then at the end of the day, it'd be up to the Fury camp to make their decision. But make it that what you will. John Fury is ruling out the Joe Joyce fight as well as Tyson himself has in the past, saying that Joe Joyce needs to get his Instagram followers up. So make that what you will. And then to close the video out, just wanted to give my little thoughts on the Showbox main event from Friday night between Shannar Bunch and Brian Flores. It was a good fight. You know, I'm familiar with Shannar Bunch because I watched Shannar Bunch in 2021 when he got robbed against Janelson Figueroa. But you know, Shannar Bunch has been quite busy since the Janelson Figueroa fight. You know, I come to learn that you know, not so long after that fight, Shannar Bunch signed a co-promotional deal with Samson Lukowicz, which is kind of strange because you never really see Samson Lukowicz in the corner of black fighters. It's always a Latino fighter. But you know, Shannar Bunch is a good talent. So you know, Samson knows talent. Samson knows how to develop talent. So that's why he signed him. But you know, Shannar Bunch has had about four or five fights since the Janelson Figueroa. It wasn't a loss. It was a majority draw. That's what it was. It was a draw. And you know, most of it has been against nondescript opposition, and you know, most notably a faded Hank Lundy. So he was taking on Brian Flores, who was 23-0 coming in. You know, an Ismael Salas fighter. Educated pressure fighter, and this fight was a tale of two fights. You had Shannar Bunch early on, boxing well, moving well, boxing very well behind that jab. You know, Shannar Bunch has that long amateur background, 400 amateur fights. You know, he's well schooled, and it showed early on as he showed his class with a jab, scored a knockdown early in the first round. But then after about four and a half rounds, he started to look like a front runner. You know, Flores started to close the gap. Flores started to beat up that body. Flores really started to make himself, his presence felt in the fight. And it looked like as the rounds went on, that Shannar Bunch had to really grind his way through the rounds and get through the rounds. And the fight ultimately wound up going the distance, the full distance, you know, the full, what was it, 10 round distance. And Flores was awarded a decision, and he actually upsets Shannar Bunch. So with that being said, shout out to Flores. You know, one thing we know about Ismael Salas fighters, they come to fight and they're educated and they're well prepared. But you know, you look at Flores right now, Flores is ranked number 35 on BoxRec. So if you just look at some of the names around, in and around him, if you go a couple spots up at 33 and 32, you got Orestes Velasquez, who is making some waves in the pros with 7 fights. You know, he's already beaten an Ismael Salas fighter. Why not try to do it again? That'd be a good fight. Kenneth Sims Jr., you know, top fighter in the division, who's not really getting his opportunity. There's some good fights out there for Brian Flores. I think a win like this makes him a fringe contender of sorts, you know, because Shannar Bunch, like I said, he's a good fighter. He was on a 4 or 5 fight win streak coming into the fight. And really, you know, the fight could have went either way, but I just think ultimately when you're Shannar Bunch and you're leaving that many rounds on the table, you know, you put yourself in that position. You know, he really didn't have any semblance of a right hand in this fight as the fight progressed. And I think that would have made a world of difference because it would have stopped Flores from coming in. But Flores did a great job, I think, of constantly attacking the body, breaking down Shannara Bunch, and making him move a lot less as the fight went on. So good win for him and a good fight on Showbox. So, yeah, that's those are my thoughts on some news in a fight from over the week. But let me know what you guys think in the comments down below. Make sure you guys take the time to subscribe. And like I say in every single one of these videos, you can love me or you can hate me, but I'm just a kid from Daniel. So until next time, take care, guys.
Thank you for watching another video on The Untouchable True School Sports Empire. For more great boxing content just like this video, click right here and make sure you subscribe. Much love from sunny South Florida.